seated. On behalf of the family, I'd like to thank everyone for coming and showing their support and their care for them during this time of mourning and also a time of celebration of a life lived for the Lord and pleasing to Him. We want to glorify God today as we remember the person that God made, Mona, and the work that He has done in her life and that has brought to completion at this time. And so we want to honor and glorify the Lord and remember Mona today. Would you bow with me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank You and praise You. You are worthy of all praise. We thank You for the role that You played in Mona's life. The transforming power of Your gospel. We thank You that You are the great comforter. You're with us in times of need, Lord. We pray that each one feeling lost at this time would be running to Your arms, Lord, that are open and ready for those who know You and those who don't. Your arms are open. We ask that You be with the family and helping them mourn and helping them celebrate and honor You even through the loss. So be with us now in Jesus' name.
If you're able, would you stand and join me in singing 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus, verses 1 and 4. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Janet Popescu. I'm Lauren's oldest niece. Aunt Lauren, I'm sure for each of you here, her name immediately evokes a memory. Possibly her infectious giggle and a zany sense of humor. Perhaps eating at her table. She was a good cook and always a welcoming and entertaining hostess. Maybe you think of a saleswoman extraordinaire, because as long as I can remember, she was always selling something. She was born to wheel and deal, and was very successful at it, from Avon to real estate. What about her ability to pinch a penny? Always on the lookout for a good deal, and if a bargain existed, she could spot it. She would drive across town to save a nickel. She was creative and handy, forever teaching herself some new skill. I remember rock polishing and jewelry making, feather art, refinishing antique furniture, woodworking, and later painting, to just name a few. She had a cross-stitch needlepoint sampler in her kitchen that always amused me. I'm not sure if she actually made it, but it was certainly something that she would have. It said, never criticize your wife's faults. It may be these small imperfections that kept her from getting a better husband. She might have been a little bit competitive. Whether she was running a three-legged race with her grandson, making an Easter basket for a contest with live baby chicks, playing tennis, joining a weight loss group, or selling houses, she went hard with enthusiasm, grit, and determination. After all, we know Roselle's play to win. She was an entertaining storyteller, as she would relate some recent escapade, and was always fun to listen to. I remember as a little girl sitting quietly on the high stool in the kitchen, hoping no one would notice I was there and send me up to play, so so I could listen in on the auntie's chatter. And if Auntie Eileen or Aunt Lorraine were there as well, you knew there would be great stories and lots of laughs. Probably because Mona was my mom's only sister, we spent a lot of time with the Drysdale family growing up. As siblings, we have many fond memories of Christmases and Easter spent together in Estevan or at my mom and dad's. We sometimes holidayed in Waskasoo with them in the summer, and mom and dad often went to Clear Lake with Don and Mona in later years. More recently, we have spent many Thanksgivings together at Echo Lake Camp. And then, of course, all the times we spent in Estevan, the big city for us, during summer break, when Mona often hosted some grouping of my siblings and other cousins over the years. It was such fun to ride bikes on pavement, to go to the swimming pool, to sleep in the tent trailer in the driveway, to walk to the paddling pool by yourself. They had a milk delivery chute, and the Dickie D guy came regularly. Fun times and good memories. Sadly, my mom is unable to be here today, but a couple of weeks ago, when my sisters and I were reminiscing with her, she recalled these stories about Mona. Mona as a little girl. The story goes that some of her brothers were teasing her at the table one day, and she was kicking up quite a fuss. I guess her mom had had enough and finally said, "For goodness sakes, just give it to her. You know what kind of a kid she is. She's just going to keep hopping." Well, you didn't have to tell Mona something twice. So several days later, when the brothers were back at it tormenting her, Mona said, "You know what kind of a kid I am. You better just give it to me or I'm going to call it." Unfortunately for her, her mom overheard that interaction, put an end to that, and that ploy never worked again. Mona as a preteen. Mom said she always had trouble with her feet, or actually it was more likely with her shoes. Mom said they had really cheap, poorly made shoes, and they always hurt Mona's feet. As a result, she had a bad habit of abandoning them wherever. My mom was working already at this time, and of the story, and she had bought her a new cute little dress. It's probably why she recalls it. Once again, Mona's shoes were missing and couldn't be found anywhere. So she suffered the humiliation of going to Sunday school barefoot in her new dress. The shoes were later found on the seat of the Harrows, completely ruined, as it had rained during that time, and the cardboard used to construct the soles had lost all integrity. How times have changed. How many pairs of shoes do we have in our closets now? Mona, as a young married woman. This final story, I think, is a perfect example of Mona's crazy sense of humor and her love of a practical joke. The day of my mom and dad's wedding, Mona found what has always been described as a very ratty old fur collar from an old coat. She then proceeded to cut it into long strips and sewed it to the bottom of Mom's new nightgown. When Mom opened her suitcase that night on her honeymoon, there it was, right on top, with a note attached that said, "Keep collar up." Something about keeping her neck warm. And while Mom thinks this story is hilarious now, 72 years ago, as she slammed the suitcase shut, she was mortified. Can't you just imagine Mona giggling at that? David, Carrie, Susan, and I, three of my siblings, had the privilege spending a couple of hours with Mona her last afternoon here on Earth. We took a little walk down memory lane, recalling some favorite times with her and her family. And while she was no longer able to respond verbally, she was aware we were there, and we were able to tell her we loved her and that she had been a good aunt and sister to my mom. While we were there, Uncle Terry called. I held the phone for her, and those blue eyes lit up. She grinned and nodded several times as he spoke with her. We were so thankful Bev had let us know that she was failing, and we were able to have that time with her. She looked lovely and peaceful. So many good memories of a life well lived. My mom grew up on a farm near Congress, Saskatchewan, 9 miles north of Assiniboia. She was the fifth child of nine. There were 7 boys and 2 girls. My mom was extremely generous and good-hearted. She was often the first person to help someone in need. A number of years ago, she gave money anonymously to 3 Bible college students in order to help them through school. Also, we knew a young single mom who did not have money for Christmas gifts. Mom paid her a visit bearing a box of Christmas oranges and $200 to help her with Christmas expenses. My mom was athletic and loved to play sports. She had fond childhood memories of playing ante over and ball. She even pitched some games for Govins, a government insurance team. She also loved to play tennis and did so until well into her 70s. She traveled to a number of out-of-town tennis tournaments and collected several medals. My mom had a very successful real estate for 20 years, working 6 days a week. She often had her photo posted in the Regina Leader Post for top sales and was well known in the community as an accomplished realtor. She said, "I loved it. You don't stay at a place very long if you don't like it." My mom was a very hard worker and was always busy with something. She seldom sat down. When mom and dad were first married, they took in boarders downstairs in their little Regina house and had renters in the upper level. They both worked full-time as well. My mom also loved sales. When I was young, we lived in Estevan, where she sold things like Avon and Nutramedics makeup. She worked out of her house so that she could be at home to raise her 3 children. My mom also had a garden as long as I can remember. One summer, she had 3 gardens, one in our yard in southeast Regina, a community rental garden on the west side of Regina, and a 3rd one in a friend's backyard in north central Regina. That summer, when she was hospitalized and unable to drive or care for her gardens, guess who needed to tend all 3 gardens in all 3 corners of the city? It was busy. A few years later, after she moved out of her house and into a condo, I asked her if she missed gardening. I was more than surprised to hear her say, "I never liked gardening." My mom was a great cook. She always made sure there was something on the table that each person liked. Many of you have enjoyed her cooking and her baking. She used to make a delicious sour cream chocolate cake with real cream from the farmers. She also made a deadly grasshopper pie. That doesn't sound very good, does it? But it's actually pretty good. No grasshoppers in it. My mom was very talented and accomplished. One of her talents was painting. She had some lovely watercolor paintings and sketches displayed in her room. My mom made a lot of crafts over the years and later loved to make greeting cards for people. When I was a young girl in Pioneer Girls, Mom volunteered and was often in charge of crafts. One craft she was organizing required colored feathers. So she dyed dozens of feathers and put them in a dryer. Do you know what happens when you put feathers in a working dryer? They fly through the dryer vent and all over the yard and the neighborhood. This sent her scurrying into our yard and all surrounding yards to attempt to collect all of those brightly colored flyaway feathers. She had a bandsaw and a scroll saw in their basement workshop where she enjoyed woodworking. She loved to make birdhouses, among many other wooden creations. My mom was known to mix the laundry. I remember a time when everyone in our family was complaining of itchy skin. It was discovered that mom had washed a load of fiberglass curtains with our underwear. Fiberglass is not really what you want next to your skin. We were all scratching for a couple days. My mom always had a saying. You remember all those sayings our parents and grandparents used to say? Like, well, here are some of her favorites. You made your bed, now lay in it. Penny saved is a penny earned. And that was so true with my mom. Stitch in time saves nine. The squeaky wheel gets the grease. Never look a good gift horse in the mouth. A watched pot never boils. Bakers can't be choosers. And I didn't just fall off the turnip truck. My mom had notes. I found notes everywhere. Every little book and her many address books had notes. Notes like this. John Newton wrote Amazing Grace while captain of a slave camp and wrote it to a Negro spiritual tune. Negro spirituals are played only on black keys. I don't know if that's true. Kind of interesting. My mom had notes about health. Pickle juice is the best thing for getting your electrolytes up. Tomato juice and lime juice is good for hangovers. I'm not sure why you care about that, Mom. Asparagus is good for liver cleanse. Put pineapple on meat before cooking it. Leave it on for 30 minutes before you cook it. It will break down the proteins. Chop garlic and put it in some olive oil. Put a drop or two in your ear for ear infection, or put a garlic clove right into your ear and put a piece of tape over it. Leave it in overnight for an earache. And this one, vinegar works as underarm deodorant. Also, vodka will work. I think I'm going to try that. My mom had random oats. If you want nice, clean, fresh oats, you have to pay a fair price. If you want cheaper oats, you must be willing to take oats that have already been through the horse. So we do that. The nice thing about being senile is being able to hide your own Easter eggs. Don't let your mind wander, it's too small to be out on its own. And this little story is entitled Black and White. Attending a wedding for the first time, a little girl whispered to her mother, "Why is the bride dressed in white?" Her mother replied, "Because white is the color of happiness, and today is the happiest day of her life." The child thought about this for a moment, then said, "So why is the groom wearing black?" A bad headache is like having two monkeys inside your head fighting over one banana. She used to say that.
A man asked his friend what he was carrying in the package under his arm. The friend said, "Oh, I bought a bouquet of flowers for my wife." The friend said, "That was a good trade." My mom was a very strong and determined woman. She endured many obstacles in her life, having married two sons, a husband, and a son-in-law. She survived cancer 3 times and recovered from long, complicated surgeries and medical procedures. In 1975, when she was 44 years old and only 2 weeks after her first mastectomy, she was on her hands and knees washing the kitchen floor. She never gave up. Sometimes I would tell her she was stubborn, and she would quickly say, "I'm not stubborn, I'm determined." And that was, I think, both true. I think she was pretty stubborn, too. My mom was far from perfect. She had flaws just like the rest of us. There were times she and I did not see eye to eye. Yet she was my mother, and she taught me a lot about how to live life. I loved my mom. I respected my mom. And I will miss her.
Raise a sunless friend. build a stairway and memories a lane. We'd walk right up to heaven and bring you back again. It broke our hearts to lose you, but you did not go alone. For part of us went with you the day God called you home. God looked around his garden and he found an empty place. Then he looked down upon the earth and he saw your precious face. He put his arms around you and he lifted you to rest. God's garden must be beautiful. He always takes the best. Yes, he always takes the best. We knew that you were suffering. We knew you were in pain. We knew you'd never get well on this earth again. So he closed your weary eyes and he whispered, "Peace be thine." Then he took you up to heaven, so gentle and so kind. God looked around his garden and he found an empty place. Then he looked down upon the earth and he saw your precious face. He put his arms around you and he lifted you to rest. God's garden must be beautiful. He always takes the best. Oh, God's garden must be beautiful. He always takes the best.
Well, that you're gone.
Let the trumpets play and the angels sang every sweet refrain of amazing grace, and that heaven's hands opened up the gate and the children danced when they saw your face. As happy as they were to see you coming, I was just as sad to have to watch you go. Oh, but knowing what I know about heaven, believing that you're all the way home, knowing that you're somewhere better, is all I need to let you go. I could hope that I could pray you back, but why on earth would I do that when you're somewhere life and love never ends? Oh, knowing what I know about heaven, where every single voice makes a joyful noise, how sweet the sound when the saints rejoice. To every broken heart and every wounded soul, new life begins on streets of gold. With every tear that's raining here from my eyes, I know the sun is shining where you are. Oh, knowing what I know about heaven, believing that you're all the way home, knowing that you're somewhere better, is all I need to let you go. I could hope that I could bring you back, but why?
She was like. So thank you for that. As we look into Scripture and reflect on her passing, I hope to be a comfort to the family and to give some challenges to those who are here as well. I want to remind you that in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13, it says, But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. We don't have to grieve as the rest of the world does, that does not have a hope in Jesus Christ. Those of us who know that, it's not the same kind of grief. Obviously, the grief of still missing someone and they're no longer there. But not the grief of not knowing where they're going. We do know. Based on Mona's testimony, based on her profession of faith, her hope was in Jesus Christ. And he is a sure and faithful Savior. Those who have heard that confession themselves and seen the evidence of the Holy Spirit's working in her life and the fruit of the Spirit can have all the more comfort during these times. You know, scripture reading today is 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 to 8. It says, "For I am already poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which is the Lord's. The righteous judge will award it to me on that day, and not only me, but also to all who have loved his appearing." I don't know how many of you have participated, most likely, like myself, in my younger years, long distance running. I've never been on a long run in a race specifically. You are working so hard and sacrificing so much to do your best. It's, you know, pretty much torturing your body. I never appreciated that. That's why I didn't continue doing it. But you're torturing it. You're giving everything you have so you can finish the race well. You leave all of it there. And so when you're done, you are completely done. My brother was much better at this. He would actually, he would throw up almost after every race because he went so hard. That's what we're talking about with our lives, struggling with Mona. She went hard, fought the good fight, finished the race, kept the faith in order to receive that reward. There is a reward for those who give their life to the Lord and serve him. All those who have loved Christ's appearing. This is great news because we are not worthy. We are not worthy of any rewards, any of us, in and of our own merit. We all are broken and sinful people, every one of us, including Mona. But it's only through faith in Jesus Christ, who paid for our sins, through death on the cross. That's how Mona was saved, but she put her faith in Jesus. Jesus, out of love for us, went to the cross, endured an undeserving criminal's death, because he loved us so much and was willing to take our sin with him to the cross, and to take that, and to die with it, so that we might be forgiven. And God raised him from the dead, showing him this is his son. So we can be forgiven if we would just put our faith in Jesus Christ. And now, since Mona did that, based on her confession of faith, we know that she now has Christ's righteousness in her, not her own. Christ's. It is not dependent on how good we are. It's about how good our God is. About us humbly asking for forgiveness before him. Saying, "I'm not good enough on my own. I need you, God. When we look at Romans chapter 10, verses 8 to 13, it says, but what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith we proclaim. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. For the scriptures say, everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew or Greek, for the same Lord is Lord of all, bestowing his riches on all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved, will not be put to shame. We understand that's what Mona did. And she will not be put to shame. No one who puts their faith in Jesus Christ will be disappointed. Or you can even say Romans chapter 8, verse 31 and 39 apply. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who is raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes, it is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. Knowing all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor heights, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. What a comfort that is for those who have placed their faith in the Lord, for the loved ones of those who have passed. What an amazing comfort it is, and peace there is in the forgiveness of Christ. I'm sure that Mona would want me to ask you, do you have this same comfort? This is of greatest importance. All the other things in life are but a mist, but a vapor. This is the one thing that truly lasts and truly matters. You need to ask yourself, who is Jesus? Who is he? Do you have this comfort? Can you say, as Mona does, that God is for you? Is his favor on you today, and will he graciously give you all things in Christ? When the devil accuses you of all your wrongdoings in your life, will Jesus intercede for you? How will God judge you? If you're being honest with yourself, and you don't have Christ in your life, it's not looking too great. None of us measure up to the righteousness of God. And in that healthy place of there should be a little bit of fear there. That healthy fear of the Lord, that's when the beginning of understanding truly starts. The beginning of wisdom, Proverbs says. Understand, I need a Savior. I need to be saved. I can't do this on my own. I can't be good enough. We need Jesus Christ. Would you seek today this great love that nothing can separate you from? This is available to you. It's available to us all. We are all sinners. What we're called to do, as we read in Romans 10, 8 to 13, we are called to believe in our heart
confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, and you will be saved. You say, God, the way I'm living is not right. I'm sorry. I'm going to live for you. You're going to be my Lord. You're going to be my King. Because I believe you. You are who you say you are, and you've done what you said you're going to do. I believe in you. When we do that, that's available to all. We would surrender, humble ourselves, and say, I need you. This is the great comfort for the believer. And for us who love ones who have been lost. So for the family, I'd like to read this Romans chapter 8 one more time. But I'd like to take the liberty of inserting Mona's name when it's talking about the believer. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for Mona, who can be against Mona? He who did not spare his own son but gave him up for Mona, how will he not also graciously give Mona all things? Who shall bring any charge against Mona? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for Mona. Who shall separate Mona from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, Mona is more than a conqueror through him who loved Mona. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor heights, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate Mona from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, each one of us needs you. We need you so desperately. We thank you that you provided a way through Jesus Christ for us to be forgiven and made right with you, Lord. We praise you and thank you. We pray that anyone here today that does not know you, that does not have this comfort and security of your love, that cannot be separated from, pray that they would surrender to you today and choose to follow you. We thank you that Mona has this salvation. That is such the greatest comfort for her loved ones who are still with us. So we thank you for this peace and this comfort. In Jesus' name, amen.
Again, if you're able, could you stand with me and sing What a Day That Will Be? Thank you.
You may be seated. I'd like to close with a few words of announcements, and then we'll pray together. First off, family wants to invite you to join them downstairs for a time of fellowship and luncheon. So please do spend a little time visiting and comforting one another. I believe the way that it'll work is just through these doors and down the stairs. I'm going to lead the family out first and give them an opportunity to go through the line. And if the food is ready right now, we'll just have you go through the line first as you get down there, so there may be a line up the stairs. That way then you can find a seat afterwards, and there's not as much confusion going from tables to seats. If not, who's not quite ready, feel free to find a seat. But please do join us. Would you bow with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time of celebration, of the blessings that Mona was to her family members, and those who are represented today are here because they've been touched by her life. And those that, as well as her kids and the lives that they've touched, Lord, we thank you for the support that we have here today. Pray that we continue into our fellowship time. We ask that you bless the food to our bodies, Lord, and bless the fellowship that we have with one another. We ask that you would help us each to, by your Spirit, know how to best comfort the family, how to best bless them during this time. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand as we